Existence is trying to destroy itself. That is what we're feeling here in this world now. Intuitively, we feel that there's some diabolical plan that is squeezing us, tightening the noose every single day, feeling a loss of freedom, feeling we're being like cattle, being herded into the cattle cars, like lemmings being driven off the cliff or being turned into these mindless drones. So we feel the pressure, and it really is a plan. There's a plan for existence to destroy itself. So we respond to this in one of two ways. Either we fight against this plan and thwart it somehow, or we sidestep the whole thing and realize that this plan has no chance of succeeding. It's a waste of time. It's simply a waste of our time, a waste of the planner's time. Simply not anything that we need to defend against or do anything about. It's simply a fantasy. So basically, we have to choose between one of those two options. And it's a very important time because the noose is really tightening severely. And of course, the more it tightens, the more we get distracted, the more the world distracts us. That's how it works. The song and dance of distraction, the siren song. We think, oh, look how lovely those sirens are. Let us keep piloting our ship towards them. And of course, when we do that, we're not paying attention to the reefs. And we get close to the siren, boom, run aground on the reef. The ship is wrecked. That is exactly what we're facing now in this world. There is this diabolical plan that has been going on for eons in existence to destroy existence. It's like existence is working to destroy itself, believing that through the complete destruction of existence, out of that will come some magical power to create a new reality. Okay, that is the belief. And this crazy idea, is at our doorstep and has been, is the earth is now in its crosshairs, okay, of this plan, very much so. And you can feel it. You can and red flags everywhere. And yet the distractions are so severe and the fear of it so severe, we tend to stick our heads in the sand. But what we should be doing is asking ourselves, should we try and thwart it? Or should we simply let it pass us by completely? Two different techniques. One is complete non-resistance. One is creative resistance, creative alternative. The other is perfect defenselessness and non-resistance. Those are the two options right now that we are struggling with. And these are of utmost importance to discern which way to go. Now, I've always been leaning towards the perfect non-resistance, love your enemies, perfect defenselessness. I've always leaned in that direction, not quite understanding it all, but sort of intuitively, I sense a true wisdom there, that there is some dynamic at play there. And this is now brightening up for me, brightening up. I'm starting to see. I remember reading a line in A Course in Miracles saying, our perfect safety lies in our defenselessness, perfect defenselessness. That reality needs no defense. And I said, huh? What is this being talked about here? I don't understand that. How can we be perfectly safe when we're perfectly defenseless? It's a challenge to understand that. It is a real challenge, and somehow it's starting to brighten up. I'm starting to see it. And that is that loss, in order, existence is trying to destroy itself for a purpose. It believes it's going to be able to create a new reality, gain a power to create a new reality out of this destruction. And it can be prime creator. The spirit can be prime creator now. And so it has to be a destruction of something. It cannot be a destruction of nothing, because that obviously could not give rise to any power. It's a meaningless statement. Well, what did you destroy? Nothing. I destroyed nothing. Well, so this whole plan of existence to destroy itself has to have it be a meaningful destruction. It has to feel that there's resistance. Meaningful means resistance. You see, existence believes it's destroying reality, but it's really destroying itself. But it has to believe it's trying to destroy itself. It has to believe that there is something there that doesn't want to be destroyed, that is resisting destruction. There's something meaningful there. If there was nothing there and no resistance, the effort to destroy, for loss to take place, total loss. The purpose of this plan of existence is total loss of existence. Existence wants total loss, and that will result, it believes, magically in a gaining of more than everything. In order for this to happen, it has to be loss of something, right? How can you claim a loss of nothing? Let's say you go into a financial situation and you go into court and you say, "Judge, I'm going to prosecute this person because I lost a lot to them." And the judge says, "What did you lose?" He said, "Well, I lost nothing to them." And the judge will say, "What are you talking about? I mean, case, throwing the case out of court. If you didn't lose anything, why are you complaining? I mean, what's the point here?" It has to be loss of something, and that something is the battle against loss. Because that, well, if there's a battle against loss, if we're opposing this idea of destruction and loss, if we're opposing it, then the destructivity feels there's something there to destroy, something important to destroy. It's like destructivity is blind without resistance to it. It feels the resistance and says, "Aha, there's something there. I got to go after that." But let's say that we gave no resistance, no defenses, no resistance, no defenses, not need to do anything. Then destructivity would be scanning, you know, on its scanners, looking for defensiveness, looking for someone protecting something of value, because defenselessness means obviously protecting something of value. Someone is protecting something of value. Let's say there's no defensiveness at all. Then this destructive dynamic will just say, there's nothing there. I'm going to look elsewhere. And it will pass by this defenselessness. So let us say that there was someone here in existence that had perfect defenselessness. Literally, it's like existence couldn't even see them. It's the destructivity, the plan of destructivity, could not even see them, would not even acknowledge them. They would be like invisible, like nothing. And the plan of destructivity would refuse to acknowledge them, because it cannot stand, it cannot entertain the notion that there's something there that it cannot destroy. It has to believe it can destroy everything. And so if you talk about something that it doesn't even acknowledge can exist and can't see it or at all, it's going to say, no, there's no such thing. That's fantasy. That's crazy. Nothing there. And they say, "There's nothing there to see. Let's move on." It's like that. So, and yet those who are oriented towards defenselessness, and Jesus said the meek shall inherit the quote-unquote earth, it should be the meek shall inherit the kingdom. Defenselessness, in other words, shall be the true inheritors, be inheritors of true life, because they will be passed over by the whole mechanism of destructivity. And keep in mind that destructivity, again, requires defensiveness. That's like a signal to it to attack. There's something there to a value that someone believes is vulnerable. Okay, so let's keep hammering away at this because it is utmost importance that we see this. Defense means there's something of value that one believes is vulnerable. That's why the defense is there. So automatically, attack will see that and say, aha, there's something there which attack can turn into loss. There's something there that can be converted to loss. Again, the purpose of existence really is for total loss, for existence to destroy itself, and out of that will come a rebirth into a new kingdom, a new creation, which is just magical thinking. It'll never happen. I've already seen that it's impossible that this happen. So, again, we will keep stating this. Defensiveness means that there's something of value that there's a belief in the vulnerability of something of value. And that attracts attack. Absolutely attracts attack. If there was no defenses, attack will say, there can't possibly be anything of value or any vulnerability here. There's nothing here. Because attack only believes in vulnerability. So if there's nothing vulnerable, no defenses, no value, no vulnerability, attack says there's nothing here. Pass it by. Nothing there. It literally cannot act in any way towards that. There are accounts of Jesus doing his ministry, and the religious authorities getting furious and wanting to arrest him and wanting to stone him and grab him, etc. He was right in the midst of everybody teaching and explaining to them this principle, which is really what his teachings were all about, this principle of resist not evil. And they couldn't find him. He's like invisible. Why? Because they wanted to attack him. And attack, because he was completely, had no defenses, with no resistance towards evil, they couldn't even see him. They couldn't even locate him. When their attack thoughts, the more your attack thoughts, the stronger attack thoughts get, the blinder you become. You cannot even see defenselessness. You cannot even see it. So they couldn't even find him. And he just walked right through the midst of them, and they couldn't even see him. That is the account, and I believe that's a true account, because that is definitely the dynamic that would arise based on what I've seen. So this entire matrix of attack, as it were, existence is trying to devour itself, really. And again, in order for this vast devouring, this vast loss to take place, there has to be first an enormous gain. There has to be a lot here so that it can be lost. So of course existence pumps out all sorts of stuff. It only gives it to us so that then we can lose it. And then it gives us to us again, and we lose it again, and over and over and over. Whatever we get here, certainly we're going to lose it. So this entire matrix of resistance, this loss-based dynamic, if one chooses defenselessness and no non-resistance of any evil, any loss, and realizes that nothing of value can be harmed in any way, and it's not vulnerable at all, there's no need to defend, what is real does not need any defense, then this whole matrix of attack and loss cannot even see it. And even beyond that, it insists that there's nothing there. It will absolutely leave it alone. Beyond leave it alone, it will move away from it. It will pass it by very strongly. And if anyone says, hey, there's someone there, go get him, you know, this matrix will get very upset at that person and saying, "You're trying to mislead me and waste my time," and we end up being punished very severely by this matrix. Because it doesn't fool around. You know, it wants to bring about loss and doesn't want to waste any time at this. And so it's not going to go chasing at where it sees nothing at all. No way. So I call this the Passover process, or the Passover that the matrix must pass those over who have this defenselessness. They must. Matrix must pass it over. And the stronger attack thoughts get, the more it gets passed over. So you can have a situation in this world where there are those who simply cannot locate any teachers at all, or those who are without any defenses. And if there was a teacher here like that, they couldn't ever locate. They would insist that no such thing exists. It's impossible. And they would say anyone who says such a one exists is fraudulent. It's a liar. And a deceiver. And they'd be very mad because they think there's nothing there at all. And they're asking me to pay attention to nothing. And how can loss extend itself by paying attention to nothing? So, and yet there are those who are oriented towards defenselessness, realizing that's where their safety will be found. They can find these teachers, they can be aware of them, and they will gravitate in that direction. So literally in this world, even at this point, you can have situations where there are teachers and those gravitate towards them, and the rest of the people will simply insist that no such things exist. It's not possible. And they'll just leave them alone. Completely leave them alone. I guess that the power of this is guaranteed. From what I see, it is an automatic dynamic. That there's no way around it. The matrix, this is its weak spot. This whole plan, actually the entire plan for existence to destroy itself is impossible from the very beginning. But it is possible to make it plausible, you see. There's a difference between possible and the plausible. The plan for existence to destroy itself is very plausible. It's possible to work out a plausible scenario of accomplishing this, but it can't actually be accomplished. It's not actually possible. Only the logic of plausibility seems inescapable. But it's not inescapable. An external reference point, meaning defenselessness, doesn't even have to do anything to escape it. So we don't really escape the matrix. What we do is we employ the Passover principle. Okay? The Passover principle, which is to be in this defenselessness, no resistance to evil, no resistance to loss or attack, realizing that nothing real can be attacked, and only the real has value. And therefore, the entire matrix of attack and loss has to pass us by, from top to bottom. And again, they will vigorously reject any notion if someone says, "Go get them, go attack them," you know, and pointing out to the matrix, "Go get them." The matrix will be very, very cross with them, punish them severely for it, because they say, "You're just trying to waste time. There's nothing there, nothing there." It's very certain of that. The more one is in attack thought mode, the blinder one becomes. Literally cannot see defenselessness, cannot see it, cannot recognize it at all. It does not exist for them, for attack thoughts. No, has no existence as far as attack thoughts is concerned. None. This is the Passover principle that I am seeing now And it's like, holy cow, this is really something. The meek shall inherit the kingdom. The meek meaning those who are without, who are defenseless. Those are the ones. Because there's nothing else. When the Matrix passes them by, what's left over? The kingdom. Matrix is just a dream of forgetfulness of the kingdom of heaven, of reality. You see, when Spirit wanted to be prime creator, Spirit had to try and forget reality. Because in reality, Spirit is not prime creator. So what else can it do except try to forget it, deny it, reject it, said no, no such thing. Has to try and forget it. So this dream of forgetfulness, in which there's an attempt to generate some power or ability for a new creation by existence destroying itself, consuming itself, as it were, this is just simply a dream of forgetfulness. And so when that dream passes one by, what is left but remembrance? That's all. Remembrance is just there. And in our case, there's a halfway house, so to speak. If I say the lost free realm is simply there, all, and I've explained that in detail in other videos. I will again, coming up probably, or certainly. It's there. It's simply there. It's not that you fall into any abyss. So, the Passover principle seems to be the most profound and inescapably effective and safe way to go about it, from what I'm seeing at this point. It seems extraordinarily promising. And we will have to see how this, if clarification arises around this, if there's some kind of support. I would expect some type of support around this to boost it. And we'll see if that happens. Because as far as I've seen, the Passover principle, it really fits. It fits the situation. It fits everything. It fits the teaching that's in the Bible by Jesus. It fits the ancient traditions of Passover. The blood of the lamb, I mean, the lamb is a symbol of meekness, of defenselessness. And so the blood is a symbol of those attributes of the creature. The blood is supposed to contain the attributes of the creature. So by putting those attributes over one's house, the idea is Egyptian armor, army passed over the Jewish people in Egypt, and that tradition is a symbol, symbolic way of talking about how attack and loss, that whole scenario of existence, the matrix of loss, must pass over those who have these attributes of defenselessness and meekness. It has to. And then Jesus clarified this extraordinarily well. And then in A Course in Miracles, it's been clarified to a much greater extent. Very, very much clarified. Very adamant. The basic teaching of defenselessness is the key, is the Passover principle, is all important. So we do have this. It fits in with the Jesus' teaching, the ancient traditions. It fits in with A Course in Miracles. It fits in with what I've seen. Everything is seeming to gel right now, as this is the safe way to go about it. But again, I keep an open mind, and additional clarification is needed, and we'll see what type of boost can take place at this point. Is there any support for this viewpoint? It's not a viewpoint that is expressed often in this world, really, or that I really hear. I've not it all snapped together internally within my own clarification. Suddenly I just was able to see how this all fits. But it's not like I just read a book that explained it exactly like this. It just suddenly snapped together, and I said, oh, wow, this really fits. You know, when you have something really fit well, it's an attention getter, because you're so used to struggling to put a, you know, a square peg in a round hole, and you keep struggling, and suddenly you get a round peg in a round hole, and it's like, oh, that fits, wow. And then you kind of wonder, is this real? Is this really, does it really fit, etc. The Passover principle, is something that is come to light. Now the question might be, how do we get perfect defenselessness, etc., etc.? Well, to some extent, it is a matter of degree. Like I said, the more one has attack thoughts, the blinder they become to defenselessness. It also means that those who have low levels of defensiveness, very meek, maybe not perfect, but low, they seem very unappetizing to destructivity. Very unappetizing. It's like they look like an ant. You know, destructivity is after an elephant, you know. It's after the big fish. And very meekness seems to have to be a very, very, very scrawny little ant. You know, how can they get any calories out of that? So they will just scorn going after the ants. Absolutely scorn that. Now, destructivity wants calories. So it wants resistance. The greater the resistance, the more calories it sees. It's like a flashing, it's like a red bull. It's like a red cape to a bull. Yeah. Maybe that's a slip of the tongue to Red Bull, which is, of course, an energy drink, which I tell everybody, stay away from them. Like because that energizes defensiveness, okay? It really does. I gotta speak out about this. Not judging anybody, okay? I'm not here to judge anybody what they do. I'm only here to point out the dynamics, and then you make your own choices. Yeah, sure, if someone wants to drink a Red Bull, you know, why not? But let me point out the dynamics, and that is when you get real energized and aggressive through these caffeinated energy drinks, you feel like empowered, like Superman or Superwoman. You say, wow, I can really resist evil. I can really throw up a lot of defenses. I got all this stuff that's really valuable, and I got to defend it. And you suddenly become, you know, like a light goes on. You say, man, I got to dig in and get in and really defend all this. And when you do that, it's like, again, like flashing a red cape to a bull. The bull sees that red cape and says, aha, I feeling all sorts of defensiveness there. There must be something very valuable that someone doesn't want to lose. I see a great opportunity to inflict loss. And then boom, there you go. You've jumped the shark. Whereas if you are very mellow, very meek, very humble, very meek, mellow, full of forgiveness, full of non-resistance, defenselessness, those attributes, the bull is looking and sees nothing, doesn't see a red cape flashing there. So there's no loss. It's the conclusion, the bull says, well, there must be nothing there because there's no defenses, nobody protecting anything, no claims of value or anything at all. So nothing there. No reason to look there. Automatically, you know, pays no attention. Looks right past it. It's looking. The bull is looking for the red cape. Okay. This massive attack on planet Earth is looking for the red cape. It's looking for that of value that people value. What do we value here? What do we protect? What do we defend? It's looking for that. Those are the telltale signs. It's psychic. It's very psychic. It's very intuitive. This whole effort is a very psychic, intuitive, kind of subtle, that is able to sense all this stuff. Is able to detect it. It's able to detect defensiveness. It's able to then detect the level of value that someone is feeling, and the amount of loss that they're worried about. And that just attracts them like a magnet. Whereas if there's no worry about loss, no defensiveness, or low levels, very low levels, then there's no attraction. I mean, a magnet is attracted to what? Magnetized materials, for instance, like iron. So if you're not magnetized by defensiveness in any way, as a sort of analogy, or metaphor, whatever, you're not attracting that magnet. You're not being pulled towards it. You're not being pulled in to the black hole, as it were, of destructivity. It's like destructivity is like a black hole, and it's trying to pull everything into it. Okay? I mean, black holes are kind of like symbolic of the destructive nature of existence. And black holes are trying to pull all of existence into this black hole. And then out the other side of the black hole are supposed to be this anti-reality emerge, as it were. Now, anti-energy may emerge, but that's still just symbolic. Energy is symbolic of essence. All existence is simply symbolic. So it doesn't matter what happens. But the basic idea is, if you can imagine a black hole, and it's pulling everything into this black hole, everything's being pulled into it. It's being attracted. Black hole is exerting this enormous attraction, but everything has to have some other pole of attraction, you know, like a negative pole is attracting a positive pole, as it were. You know, we understand that. And let's say you were not magnetized in any way, you couldn't be pulled into the black hole then. Everything else would be pulled in, and you remain. That's another way of looking at this Passover principle. The universe disappears, but you remain. And what do you remain as? You remain in paradise, because there is an entire realm that is defenseless, has no defenses whatsoever, none. An entire realm, gorgeous, beautiful, stunning, wonderful. And that doesn't get pulled into the black hole. So when everything is getting pulled into this black hole of loss, and you're not, you find yourself in this paradise. Through defenselessness, that's the Passover principle. And we look out in this universe, and we recognize these massive black holes are just sucking everything, like a vacuum cleaner, sucking everything in, destroying stars and solar systems, planets, galaxies even. Everything is being sucked into these gigantic black holes. Total loss, total annihilation. But we do not have to be pulled into loss at all. It's only our defensiveness which says that we fear the loss of something of value in existence, and therefore we're defending against its loss. That attitude is what enables this black hole to pull you in, as long as you're embracing those attitudes, defensiveness, as long as you're being defensive, trying to defend something. You get pulled in. Pretty amazing. So really becoming as defenselessness as possible, cultivating these attitudes of meekness, humbleness. And now the question is how to do that, how to do it. And that's where our really focus needs to be, because that's where our safety is to be found. And that's where we could probably use some help. And maybe we'll get it. Maybe we'll get it, because I've been able to discern where the focus needs to be. It needs to be on this defenselessness. It needs to be on the realization that we don't really need to protect symbols of what we are. We don't really need to protect symbols of what we are. And I believe that realization will mean that the symbol of what we are will also be passed over. So we end up not, you know, Jesus said he who would lose his life would gain it, meaning he who gives up all defense, who's completely has no resistance to the whole matrix of loss. In other words, willing to give up his life, has no attachment to it, sees no value whatsoever, completely defenseless, He or she who would do that would gain their lives. In other words, they don't lose it because loss sees nothing there to take, nothing of any value. Loss is only concerned with destroying that which seems to have value, or someone's placing value upon it. Because only that has a meaning as far as loss is concerned. Loss of nothing is no loss at all. Loss of nothing is no loss at all. So being able to set the context like this of focus, that we need to work on this meekness, this non-resistance, this defenselessness, in some way, that is now the focus, the locus of focus, and the context by which some sort of spiritual help, some boost, could take place, could fit into that. And so I'm working on that. I'm looking at that and saying, yeah, that's right use. If some really very helpful spiritual being of defenselessness and meekness would come to our attention with this focus now, it may be possible. Remember I said that earlier in the video it was said that attack thoughts cannot see the defenseless, cannot see him. But those who have given up their attack thoughts to a large extent can see that. So it might be there could be someone in the world that we can't even see. We can't even recognize him. Because of our defensiveness, we can't see him. We see no value in them. So our perception literally can't even see him. Our perception works on value. What we value, if there's something we don't value at all, we can't even see it. So it may be that there are teachers here, we don't even know them, can't even see them, we can't even locate them. But as we get this focus that, oh my gosh, this is what we need to come across perfect meekness, perfect defenselessness, because that's our safety, it may very well be possible to locate this help now. Which is extremely good news, because we'll put it in the proper context. And when people say, "Ah, no, there's no teacher. I don't see any teacher there. You're crazy, blah blah blah," we understand where that's coming from now. We understand, because loss, attack thoughts, see no value in defenselessness. Nothing there, and we'll scoff at it. Absolutely scoff at it. So this is just nonsense, crazy, craziness. So you can see where the negativity would come from there, and we can just dismiss it, knowing where it's coming from, why it's there. Because again, loss, the plan of existence to destroy itself, it has to be total destruction in order for this plan to be plausible. It has to be total destruction. That's the plausible scenario, that everyone has to be sucked into the black hole. Everything has to be annihilated. And if the very notion that there's something that may not be annihilated is a complete anathema to this entire plan, and we reject it. So anyone who seems to be lagging behind, who's not being pulled into the black hole of destructivity quickly enough, existence is going to curse them. Say, what's the matter with you? Why are you lagging behind like that? You must be crazy. Come on, get with the program here. Get with the program, you know. So, I'm very optimistic right now. Highly optimistic. Because it seems like there's a willingness to set a context now for help. And before, I didn't quite have it. I didn't have it before. I knew there was some context. I just hadn't quite seen it. I hadn't seen the Passover principle yet. But now in seeing it, suddenly, it's like, wow, we should be able to locate some help now. Should be able to. And that help is like, hello, the ticket. You know, it's like the ticket to freedom, to safety. That which is totally unconcerned. Now, I know this is possible because there've been boosts in previous times in history of complete unconcern in this world, complete defenselessness. So it can take place in this world. There have been such beings here. So that I know for sure. So if it's happened once, it can happen again. And there may very well be some type of help, either maybe a being here in this world, or a being in the subtle world that we still can't see because of our defenses, keep us from seeing it. Possible too. We don't know to what extent our attack thoughts have blinded us. We don't understand to what extent our defensiveness, our fear of loss of value here in existence has blinded us. We don't realize to what degree. So the fact that we may not see something right now doesn't mean it's not there. Really, does not mean it's not there. I remember when I was young, very young, I could see the whole subtle world, all of it, all the vibrations, vibrational patterns of energy, the comings and goings of all sorts of beings, of subtle beings in the world, the activity of extraterrestrials in the atmosphere and around the world. I literally could see it as plain as I'm seeing this yard and trees right now. It was completely, and like when I would paint, make drawings, I would, all the drawings I made, I'd draw all these energy fields around what I was drawing. And people would always kind of scratch their heads and say, well, you know, why are you putting all those wiggly lines around everybody that, you know, that you're seeing? And I look at them like, what are you talking about? I was very confused. I said, aren't you seeing this? And they'd say, no. I'd say, whoa, wow, that's frightening. And so, you know, eventually, I ended up going into the consensus blindness of this world. But previously, my drawings just had all this energy, wavy lines, like coming out from everything, because that's what I was seeing. I saw all the energy fields and energy patterns, and all the activity, the subtle activity that was going on. And I know, and now I know when I lost sight of it. I realized it was still there. I just couldn't see it. I could see all these act. Oh boy, the subtle realm is extremely active. We just can't see it because of our defensiveness, because of our attack thoughts. To a large extent, it blinds us in many different ways. And most of all, it blinds us towards the great teachers, the great gurus. I was fortunate to find some in the past. They're not here anymore. But I did come across those. So I had some willingness to become aware of this, you see. Very helpful. So I'm just wondering if a willingness to have the right focus might bring about a discovery of some help. Because let's face it, we do need help. When I say, how do we reach defenselessness? Well, how do I do it? That is a big question. I don't know how to do it. I'm willing to do it, be instructed, and follow the instructions and get there. But off the top of my head, you know, just right at this moment, I can only speculate as exactly, you know, how can you do it? I'm sure I could come up with something, but I think time is of the essence. I don't think we have time to mess around right at this point. I really don't. I think we need a super teacher, someone who knows exactly how to reach defenselessness and how to give up valuing what has no value, stop defending what has no value, and experience the miracle that this brings. I mean, we call it a miracle, but really, it's an automatic principle. It's an automatic, the Passover principle, it is a principle from what I've seen, and it was very clear. Oh boy, it is automatic. We only have to now get to that defenselessness. And I know A Course in Miracles gives all sorts of exercises, and perhaps I can apply those. But it sure would be enormously helpful to get a boost at this time if there was someone who could really fine-tune the whole thing for us. I mean, it kind of like, you know, we're pointed in the right direction now. Now we need some fine-tuning. Need a little push. Once you get in the right direction, a push can be very helpful. Whereas if you're aligned in the wrong direction, a push could be disastrous, right? So let's say we got our wheels. Let's say we're faced in the right direction towards safety and freedom. And yet we got our front wheels turned, you know, 45 degrees. If someone gives us a big push from behind, we're going to go way off track, right? We go 45 degrees off track and into the, you know, off the side of the road, into the culvert or something. It'd be a big problem. But once we get those wheels, let's say we get the wheels aligned straight down the track, like the kids in the soapbox derby, they're behind the steering wheel, they got the wheels aligned straight down the track, then go. You know, then a push then will send us quickly down the track in the right direction, which is exactly what we want to do. So it seems like now that the wheels here have been aligned in the right direction. So I would assume then that a push is coming. I would assume that. And we'll have to wait and see, because at this point it is an assumption. But it's pretty exciting time right now, because we may be able to get that push that we've been hoping to get. And not a minute too soon, really. Not a minute too soon. You don't have to be a genius to realize that the months ahead, starting in August, are fraught with stress, to say the least. And we may have this little window of opportunity here as the Olympics are on, that maybe nothing much is going to happen. Maybe. Or maybe so. I don't know. But we have a little window of opportunity now. We still have time right now to get a push in the right direction. But I'm not at all confident that if we just wait and wait and wait and wait, that, you know, we have endless amount of time. No, I don't believe that at all. Because there is this plan of loss, of destructivity, and it is literally ready to munch us down. Okay, we're in its lair, as it were, and it's lining us up and it's eyeballing us. You know, you can know when something is ready to pounce, right? And it is ready to pounce. It's like a cat on a mouse. You see the cat, and the mouse is kind of wandering around, the cat's there looking, and you know it's ready to pounce, and then you see some indication that it's going to pounce. You can tell when it's going to suddenly pounce. It's like that now. There's a cat and mouse game going on. This destructivity is letting the value accrue to the utmost, you see, before it pounces. I may have to take a break here. Or I can wrap it up. So, let us set our expectations towards a big boost. And stick with it, and stick with right effort, and realize these are the times right now that are super important. Super important. Because the cat is about to pounce. And once that happens, we may be thrown into a defensive mode. When all hell breaks loose, we may be swept up in defensiveness, and that would be a very unfortunate circumstance. So, let's bring an end to this video here. It's been a pleasure sharing this video with you. Okay, that's it for this one.